rise another sun till it's going down. Your faithfulness is sure. Your birth.
When I was born in 1987, my mother and father used to live in Kakamega, a place known as Matinga. It is the central part of the forest, Kakamega Forest. I can just remember a film or a view of my father in 2000, where he gave me only 5 shillings. From that day, my mom and my dad, they had a conflict. I didn't see him from that day. And my mom also got out of that place. And then we went to live to my grandmom's place. And then 2008, they told me to go and live with my mom in Nairobi. My mom, when we were in Nairobi, told me that your dad has passed on. I didn't take it more serious. When I came back to my home, they denied me a chance to go to the home. Then my mom started mistreating me. She was even to come and take me out of the school to take care of our last born child. I was more focused on studies. I saw it like he's mistreating. And then she was beating me. Actually, she was doing me over labor. I was traumatized. I took off and I went to sell scraps. When she noticed that when she is not there, I sell scraps, she told me that it's better if you go and never come back. So I decided that if it is like that, I would rather get out of the family. I went and started moving further. This is like Down Home and Westlands, Nairobi West. I was sleeping under things they call vibanda. It was a time that I was sleeping at the railway bridge. It was more risky because it could vibrate when the train is passing at night. And I realized that I had sleepwalking. And then I moved to Nakumat. So I was sleeping to that hollow that the water I was passing through. I realized that also that place was risky because when it was raining, the water could come at once and wet me. So I moved ahead and sleep somewhere called DC near Kibera. I used to take a sleep bag. It was just a simple one, so that I could enter in a polythene bag and then with another sack, and then I cover myself. But I saw it also being risky. Some caterpillars could walk on you and you have that irritation on skin. In our area, they didn't allow the street children to take glue because glue was seen like under level. You had to take bang, cocaine, heart, or something called jet fuel. It's normally called musi. So that jet fuel, you wet on the cloth and then you inhale. So I used to go in Kenyatta Market and then buy a 5-liter jerry can. One was 200 from an Indian man who was coming from the JKIA. However small you sell it, they will buy, because I used to sell like that container of a robe, a measure of that one, 10 shillings, and I could generate about 2,000, 3,000 shillings from my 200 shillings, but I didn't really take them. I really used my money in terms of eating. I buy clothes and then when I get back, and then change it totally and throw the other ones because they had lice. Actually, when I was walking in the street, you could not notice that I sleep there. Around 2009 to 2010, I got a report that your mom is sick. I took it for granted. I was not any serious with my family. I was just trying to live my own life. And then I went to Rakids. While I was in Rakids, the report came that your mom has passed on, is in the city mortuary. So they took me from Rakids, and then they told me that we have been looking for this children home that you went through. And then I went to in the burial ceremony for 3 days at Kakamega. I remained with the relatives, and they told me there's no any need for you to go to your dad's place because your mom and your dad had the initial conflicts. And I lived with my grandmom. for a while. My last place before I was rescued was at Carland. There was a place where there was some flowers, and it was more secure. So that flowers, they had thorns. If I enter there, I close by the thorns, and then I cover myself there. On the top of the flowers, it could not rain because it was covered. You can see, like me, I was in the street, but I didn't concentrate with things like drugs or what. I knew that there is something for me, and always when I was in the street, whatever suffering I was passing through, I knew that I have to study. I told my teachers that register me, and then I will study from streets. They told me it is difficult. That's when they talked with my uncle. Although I didn't have any more resources, but I used the available resources so that I could try and go for tuition. I could also sell coffee and try to gain some money, where I used like 10 bob in tuition for Saturday and the morning tuition, evening tuition. I deny myself some games time, and I scored 312 marks, which qualified me to secondary school, finishing my KCPE. That's when I came back in Kibera and lived with my uncle for a while before being transformed and going to secondary school. At now, I'm position 8 out of 127 students in overall from 3 students. I just want to be an aeronautical engineer, and an alternative of that, it is any course related to medicine and engineering. In school, at now I'm assistant chairman of the journalism club, currently known as Media Club, and I'm also the scrum half of the rugby team in Shikunga High School, and I do choir and drawing. Actually, I'm the best artist in our school, and I'm the physics leader in the school. But I can just advise you, look forward for that you are looking, and then do your effort, avoiding the other things, assuming that they are part of life, and then focus on the studies. I think the studies are the only thing that you can do. For me, there is a philosophy that says that you are whom you are because the society wants you to be what you are. Actually, in the streets, there were many challenges. I was in the street and my fellow friends had broken in M-Pesa. The police, when they came, they took us all. We were locked in Kilimani cell. I can remember also the circumstances like rain. I also had asthma, but I could survive in the street. My way of earning was either selling scraps or begging. But as you increase in age, the begging will also reduce, because people will now be you'll be familiar with them, and you cannot earn by begging. There is some day you have maybe only 10 shilling, and there is taxation in the street. The bigger street guys will come and tell you, you have slept here for a week, you need about 2,000 or 3,000. They tax you. So if you don't have, they beat you or they chase you out, or they tell you, go and steal something to sell them. There are many challenges like fighting in street. People fight with the bottle which are broken. City council was a problem. They will only affect me if they see me begging. But they know the prediction of street guy is they are dirty. They have gum, of which I didn't have. So when I was in the town, I could also sometimes sleep on places like Florida, and then sleep with a vest covering myself. So if they see you sleeping in the town, that's when they came with their vehicle and pick you and drop you inside. But when you are not dirty, they didn't. Even sometimes you just cross with them. Actually, I don't regret leaving the streets. The thing that I'm doing to make sure that I don't think of streets is that I'm keeping myself with the studies, so that any slightest time I get, I concentrate on studies, or I even take even 20 shillings and go to library, or any slightest time I get, I go to play rugby. When I see the other street children, I don't run from them. Just tell them, you are my friends, I was like you, but one day you will have to make it. I don't really want anyone to pass through what I was to pass, although I escaped some of the situations, you know, the life is all about being patient. However, the bad situation it is, they are, like in Joseph Kangede, when I was there, I was caught twice. I can remember the first time I was caught, it was around Hilton Hotel. I was begging, and then they caught me, they dropped me to the rehabilitation center there. I can remember the life at that time, it was on 2009, it was not good. Actually, they would even give you some Gideon on hand, and you can live with it till the next morning. So I asked the student, is the life still the same? And then they told me that nowadays we eat lunch, breakfast, and the dinner. And then I told them, thank God you are fair, because we are just living and we live with us the same life. Actually, Children for Face Africa, I think, has very many impacts in my life, including the studies, including helping of my grandmoms, including the game and all of that. Actually, in terms of study, I don't think if I would be in secondary school, any other alternative was not working. And Children for Trace Africa came up with me, and they took me to high school. I can remember when they took me there, the next week they were sending people without school fees, but at there they provide school fees at adequate time, so that I've never sent school fees home. A debt of about 20,000 shillings in school, you are told to transfer because they cannot tolerate such debt. But they do best and help me. They have renewed with some sponsorship. They have helped my project of ships. They also helped my grandmom to have solar lighting. Actually, I can remember even the iron sheets at home. Living with grandmom is also another hard situation that I think it will not affect me too much, but I'm trying.
Still yet, will I praise you, Lord?